This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Hey, you! Yeah, I'm talking to you, sassy girl. Need a little in your step? Try this on for size. It's pop. It tastes great. It makes you feel kind of funny. Not here, not down there, but all up in this area. And coming
December 2018.
Jumbo Pop.
Talking
pop.
Sick and tired of hearing all these people talk about what's the deal with this pop life and when is it gonna fade out? The thing you got to realize, what we're doing is not a trend. We got the gift of melody, we're gonna bring it till the end. Come on now.
Hi, welcome to Talking Pop. I am Jennifer Smith. Am I? I am. I'm here with Tim Cable. Hey, Tim, how you doing?
We're off to a great start.
We are, aren't we?
Wow. Yeah. You know, maybe we'll have some fucking pie and sing some caroling.
And do some caroling.
Compliments to the manager, Todd Weber, for...
Y'all,
really?
What I pointed out, he made me replay it over and over and over again so he could hear it. Anyway, how are you, babe?
I'm doing okay. You know, I'm getting into the spirit of the season, I guess you could say.
The spirits, anyway.
Well, yeah, those two, all of them.
Mm-hmm. Jacob Marley, Jack Daniels.
Oh yeah, yeah. All the gentlemen that you associate with the Christmas time.
What are your thoughts on eggnog?
Eggnog. Okay, so I have had some bad times on eggnog. Let me tell you.
I believe you.
We should put one of those stories in the bank. Now that I think about it, but as much as eggnog tends to not agree with me, I agree with it quite a bit. I can't say I've ever been big on like homemade eggnog, you know, making my own or...
Who does that?
I don't know. It's a thing. People apparently... I don't know anyone who does that, but you can always find like an eggnog recipe, and I'm always too scared to really... go there, you know.
What are the ingredients of eggnog? I mean, like, I'm disgustingly fascinated with it because, like, it's so fucking gross.
Well, it's so
and
heavy,
then you put,
right? Yeah.
Yeah, just thick, like, it's, I mean, it's semen. I mean, it's like... how is it different?
Oh, well...
from actual semen?
Oh, well, both of them tend to... be the result of or result in terrible decisions. So,
yeah.
Well, you got to think with eggnog, you've got cream, you've got sugar, you've got spices, you've got whatever your alcohol is going to be, right? I mean, I don't think
there's
a lot.
Is it like a bourbon usually or like a brand?
That's the thing. There's so many genres of eggnogs. So you could do a bourbon eggnog, which is kind of my go to. Brandy, certainly. Rum. Some people like a little rum. I don't know about that one. That's a little too much sweet going on, I feel like. But, yeah, I bought this liquor store eggnog one time that had all three. Yeah. All three going
all
on.
All three? Yep. Jesus.
Yep. And,
Merry fucking Christmas, too.
Yeah, no kidding. That's the story we'll be getting to on a later date. It was good, but, you know. What are your thoughts on eggnog?
No, it's fucking gross, man. I mean,
you don't like it at all?
No.
Mm-mm. Oh, man.
And you know, me and Booze, we're besties, but no. I mean, like, give me a shot in the mouth and then, like, a shot of bourbon. Other than that, like, no thank you with the eggnog.
Huh. All right, well.
You know? It's the same thing.
Takes all kinds, I guess. That's okay.
How about you introduce our guest?
How about we bring in our guest who we've been neglecting here? Our guest is a dear, sweet, longtime, close, personal friend of both of us. I know him as Gregorian X. Phillipsian. He is the great impersonalizationalist of Place to Be Nation Pop. You know him as one half of the Hard Traveling Fanboys. Greg, how's it going tonight?
Timothy S. Capel the 17th, thank you for welcoming me aboard Talking Pop, finally.
Yes.
I know.
I am so happy to be here. I know I was here on the 90210 episode, but then that was me amongst several other luminaries, more luminous than I. But now, now I get the spotlight all to myself.
That's right.
I'm so excited.
You might regret it, actually, but I'm glad you're excited right now.
Yeah, I'm excited right now, but I end up regretting most things I do. So
yeah,
this will, I can just add this to the list. Hey, I have a thought on eggnog while I have the floor.
Please.
Not really a thought, but more a question. I'm fascinated by the nomenclature of eggnog. Like, you have egg, which is a thing, right? An egg. Mm-hmm. You know what everybody knows what an egg is.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Pretty clear.
I don't know what nog is. But you put them together and you have eggnog. Now, I don't know why it's called eggnog. I'm not familiar with what's in it. Are there eggs in eggnog?
Is
that why it's called that?
It's milk, cream, sugar, whipped egg whites, and egg yolks.
Mm. And now, egg yolks.
That's disgusting.
Now, that begs the question about the modifier egg to the word, the base word, nog. So are there other types of nog that do not involve egg? Like, is there, I don't know, I don't know, is there like chocolate nog or something? I don't know.
Well, there's an egg cream, so maybe your base word is egg here and not nog.
Well, nog is, it seems to be the operative suffix, I guess, is what we're questioning. And no, I don't know that nog is attached to any other things, but I think we should monitor that situation as it develops.
I agree. If anybody out there listening to this right now, assuming there is anyone still listening after I posed that thought.
Yeah.
Oh, I got it. Google knows everything. Okay.
Okay.
According to the Oxford English Dictionary, nog was a kind of strong beer brewed in East Anglia. Okay. Nog may stem. Hello. All right. Maybe not.
Sounds like Dandina to me.
Now I got to read 800 pages of Reddit.
Oh. I don't know about that.
And then everybody's being a dick, so I don't know.
Imagine on Reddit.
Never.
Speaking of never. Google, I would like to pose a question to both of you. And Greg, I'll start with you as our guest. What's the last thing you Googled?
Oh my gosh, let me think. The last thing I Googled would have been...
Or the last interesting / funny out of context thing. I mean,
I was going to say, the last thing was Billie Holiday, and I don't even remember why. Oh, because I wrote her name in a press release, and I wasn't sure if I spelled it right.
Yeah, I was going in my head. I was doing the mental gymnastics going,
which I did. Spell it right. The other thing that I would have Googled that was interesting was an approximately 15-word description of a treadmill that my mom wants for Christmas that had no brand name attached to it.
Oh, well.
It was just a description of the treadmill. No, I swear to you, this link's on Amazon. There doesn't appear to be any manufacturer. There is a seller, but there is no manufacturer of this product. And it had 9 reviews, all of them 5 stars.
Oh.
And I said to her, that's something of a red flag to me, because I don't know many products that have all 5-star reviews, particularly those that only have... Then I started reading the reviews, and they all read in the same voice.
Oh, no. They're fake.
My mother does not understand this premise, and so...
She doesn't understand the cottage industry of fake Amazon reviews?
No, it is tough to... Why would anyone do that? Well, I don't know. Maybe to sell their product.
Exactly.
Go figure. But you know, it's not for me to say, quite frankly. Yeah. But it is for me to say, actually, in this case, because she wants me to buy her this treadmill. And I say to her, I say, well, I don't want to buy this for you because I don't believe that it will work. which is a key thing to do for a product or service. Work.
Yes.
And now she is not happy about that. So
I am told money can be exchanged for goods and services. Mm. I think that's how that
Yes. works. Sometimes you don't even have to exchange money.
Mm. Okay. Well, this is true. Jenny, what was the last thing you Googled?
Well, I mean, other than eggnog.
Yeah. Well, that's what prompted the question, you know. Just, we can skip past that one.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how interesting it is, but it's factual in that for Thanksgiving when we had people over, we had this dish called beef and noodles. I don't know that you guys have ever heard of this, but it's
not familiar with the concept of beef and noodles.
Now,
what sorcery is this?
This is some sort of chicken?
It's the Ohio family that came in. This is what they have. It's like a roast, like a beef roast in the crock pot. Yeah. And then there's this specific type of noodles that you get, and then you put them together, and it's beef and noodles. So we had this dish, and it was delicious, but it was in these disposable bowls or whatever. So then the disposable bowls sat on my wood dining room table. Uh-oh. And then it left a white mark from, I guess, the heat or the condensation or whatever. So there's like 17 white marks all over my dining room table. Awesome. So my mother-in-law, because she knows everything,
yeah,
she told me that I should rub mayonnaise. a table
so that everything will be white,
right? And somehow it takes away the white marks. And I thought, Jenny, you need to research this before you start spreading mayonnaise all over your table. So that's what I did, and I didn't see it on any website.
That's a good way to get committed to an asylum if your significant other shows up and you are spreading mayonnaise all over the table.
Well, I mean, perhaps I do need to be committed, but it won't be for mayonnaise spreading. No. I'll tell you that much.
Okay. Very, very well.
Did it work?
I haven't tried it. One of them said, like, olive oil, so I did try the olive oil thing. That didn't work. There was a baking soda option. There was a salt option, and so I haven't tried any of those yet.
Have you tried burning the table and getting a new one?
I got a tablecloth, so...
Ah, that's good. That's same thing.
Windex. I think Windex is what you want.
I can try Windex.
Let's see. The last thing I Googled. I Googled
pants.com.
No, I don't need to Google that. let's see. There, you have to work with me here. Various combinations of early 2000s movie, interracial couple. Mountains dies of AIDS. If you couldn't guess, I was trying to figure out this movie that, and I did figure it out actually, and it wasn't worth it. I spent about 45 minutes to an hour Googling combinations of those terms. And I don't think she died of AIDS at the end, actually. Spoiler. But she did die of something. There was this
eggnog.
Movie, yeah, it was eggnog related poisoning in the early 2000s, if you can believe it. There was this movie that was on constantly, like on one of the movie channels, Showtime or Skinamax or something, but it wasn't a late night, you know, entertainment.
Softcore
option. Yeah. No, it was just a regular, like stupid, dumb indie movie that. It would. I remember having it on in the background and seeing it in like bits and pieces, and I probably had seen the movie in its entirety, just not end to end in one sitting. And I don't know what got me thinking about it. I was like, what was this fucking movie, and was it any good? And the answer is no, it was not any good. It was a movie called The Last Place on Earth, and yes, he's white, she is black. They meet in the mountains. In Lake Tahoe, and spoiler alert, she dies at the end, and it's really stupid. But yeah, it was one of those, it was bugging me. You know when something just bugs you so much, and it's like not even so much on the tip of your tongue because you don't even know how to look it up. And yeah, that's where I was, like Sunday nights coming off a long holiday weekend, gradually losing my mind. So I was glad to eventually get the answer.
Thank yeah, I do that with song lyrics. Where I won't remember the name of the song, but I'll just Google the lyric that I know from the song. And it's bad if there's a bunch of songs that have that same lyric because it's something generic like, "She loves you." I remember that being in the song. Oh, it turns out there was a song by the Beatles in 1963 called that. Well, that's not what I'm looking for. Let me just exclude term Beatles. Yeah, no. And then the other thing is if you don't remember the lyrics properly.
Yeah, that'll bite you as well. Or if you don't even remember lyrics, you just hear, you just remember like part of the song, the way it goes, and it's like, maybe, you know, what's the famous example that the Crash Test Dummy song where the
yeah, that guy.
Yes.
No. Yeah. Well, there's that's what I do with that Aerosmith song where he's like, yab dab. And but if you type that into Google, nothing comes up.
You would think enough people have searched for that.
Yeah, for real.
Now, now, Greg, you are our guest, and you are this is your sexy files and origins episode of Talking Pop. You're in the hot seat. And speaking of movies, I want to start at the beginning with you, Greg. I want to know, we're just cutting right through the shit here. What was the first movie you saw in the theater? And how old were you when you saw this film?
This is what we call in the business a softball, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, thank you.
You're laying it up for me right now, and I'm about to slam it home because the first movie that I saw in a theater was Paul Verhoeven's RoboCop.
There we go.
Yeah. 1987. My thoughts were short. My hair was long. No. I was 3 years old, and my parents took me to see RoboCop. And I fell in love.
Love it. I love it.
I specifically, my memories of that movie in the theater are I remember crying at the beginning of the movie when they're shooting up Peter Weller's character, Murphy. They're shooting up Alex Murphy, and they shoot him in the groin, and they shoot him in the hand. His hand comes off, remember?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he's just in so much pain. And I had never seen anything like it, and I was mortified. I was so – I was crying. I was like, why are they hurting him like that? And then the other memory I have
is – And your parents
is,
shushed you and said, keep watching the movie.
They said,
be quiet.
Shut the hell up. You stupid son of a bitch! No, they never said that. But they still—they just said, "Just watch. It's okay." And
just
they,
watch,
you know, they consoled
watch.
Me. So the other memory I have is the other extreme emotion, which is perhaps why I love that movie so much, because I had the emotion at an early age of crying and fearing for the life of another human being. Then later in the same movie, you remember the scene when the Ed 209 falls down the stairs and can't get up.
Yes.
I laughed so hard. I still remember my childish laughter filling the room as this little robot just pedaled its legs up and down and couldn't do anything. That was great.
And it makes little wailing sounds. It's like a turtle on its back.
It was phenomenal. Why did it make that noise? I don't know.
We don't know. Well, you know, the thing about that movie, I mean, it was appropriate for children because – I mean, there's no sex. So there's
of
no.
Of course,
there's a
the
little nudity.
Fine.
There is a little nudity in the the locker room. So you do see like the corner of some tits, I think.
Yeah, triangle tits, as I recall.
Triangle tits. Yeah, absolutely. But it's done very tastefully, right? So it's such a tasteful, you know, artful movie that
And the most important thing, the good guy wins. So like, all right, you know, in the end.
Hmm.
Yeah. My lesson that I took out of that at an early age was that don't rape and assault people. And so far, so good.
That's a great takeaway from that film.
Because if you do, a robotic cop man will kill you.
Right.
Your parents knew what they were doing after all, didn't they?
Yeah.
That was a lot easier than actually talking to me about things.
Yes.
It was like a PSA.
Watch RoboCop.
Yeah.
What did you take out of that movie, son? Robot man will kill me if I do bad things. Good enough.
I think Tim's mom and Greg's mom would be best friends.
Probably so.
Yeah, it kind of sounds that. Yeah. Well, actually, though, your mom did have some limits, right, when it came to content and film. I mean, you could not see Deborah Kara Unger's breasts in Highlander,
the final dimension.
The final dimension. Thank you. I was trying to think of the subtitle.
Yes, the oft-forgotten third Highlander film, which I would argue is the second best Highlander film.
Well, that's saying a lot.
Which is a high bar to climb. The best, of course, being The Quickening. not that. But we're watching this. We had a tradition where we would rent. We would go up to the local movie rental store, which was Video Giant,
and Video we would go Giant. There. And we would, wow! Okay.
Yeah. We would go and we would rent every Friday night an action movie to watch because there's obviously my dad's favorite genre, and my mom liked them too. She liked the Jean-Claude Van Damme of it all and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So we would rent the action film and watch it. And one of those that we rented was Highlander The Final Dimension because we loved the Highlander movie, the first one, and enjoyed Christopher Lambert and his tremendous career. And
he was so hoshy-moshy, too.
Exactly. He really was. He was almost hash-mash, dare I say.
Oh, man.
So we would rent this movie, The Final Dimension, and we're sitting there watching it, and, you know, there's people's heads being chopped off. There's Mario Van Peebles,
In a movie, yeah.
In a movie at all. there's murder and mayhem and death and people in 1700s French wigs and whatnot. And then all of a sudden, Connor McLeod takes his lady friend, and he lays her down, and there's firelight in the background, and he exposes her nude breasts.
That's right.
And my eyes grow wide as I'm like 8 or 9 at this time, probably 9 I think at this time, something like that. And maybe I'm even 10 at this point. And my mom's hand flies up to my face as if she's Evander Holyfield delivering a right hook. And she smacks me in the head and holds her hand over my eyes so that I cannot see this lovely sight before me, the naked, heaving bosom of this woman and the muscled tone ass cheeks of Christopher Lambert as they're thrusting into her.
Jenny, you got to cue this one up.
Lambert.
You got to cue that up.
I'm like, this movie sounds hot. What are we talking about?
It is. It's not. I mean, it's not as good as the first one. But hey, man, there's a nice sex scene in it. Mm-hmm. There's there's lots of Mario Van Peebles having a 9-pack and whatnot. There's a lot of stuff going on in that movie.
Yeah, no doubt. I'm just so jealous of you because you got to see RoboCop in the theater. I had to wait until I was 4 years old and see it in daycare. It's just always made me so mad. Like, I thought I could like one up anybody with my RoboCop experience, but I sure can't top that.
No, and it'll forever be in my top 5 favorite movies.
And see, mine too. So I guess you got to just catch us when we're young.
Another great moment in RoboCop that I actually don't remember watching in the theater, even though I know that I did because I saw the movie. But I just I remember just loving it as I got older. The mutant man, or he gets toxic chemicals fall on him, you know, and he's going to go, and then he gets hit by the car and he explodes.
Yes, like, yes.
Why did he explode? I don't know, but it was it's phenomenal.
The reaction of Clarence Boddicker when he hits the melting man, he just goes, shit, and hits the windshield wipers, and that's it.
He had the best reactions from that to bitches leave.
Oh my god! And the melting man, of course, Todd Weber and myself, ER alum favorite, Paul McCrane.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Oh yeah, he was the asshole doctor Romano on ER. So
did he melt and then explode?
No, but he had a hilarious.
He got hit by like multiple helicopters.
Yes, he got crushed by a helicopter.
He lost an arm to one, and then he got hit by one.
God, you talk about bad luck. Right? Holy shit. Not only did a helicopter fall on you and chop your arm off, but then another helicopter fall on you and killed you.
Yeah.
What are the odds of that?
I think it was a little over a year apart. Yeah, he got the arm chopped off.
Jeez almighty.
And then the following season, there's like this huge accident, and like the helicopter falls off the landing pad. And he looks up.
The look on his face, man.
Yeah, and just sees his demise coming at him. The helicopter, it wasn't finished with him.
ER, I'm just gonna say it. I might have actually watched ER if it had turned into a movie into a show about a sentient helicopter that goes for revenge on people.
It's not an unlikely story arc for this particular stretch of ER history.
I just wrote sentient helicopter down for next year's draft.
There probably has been a sentient helicopter in comics. Tim, has there?
Oh, well, there's the Thanos copter, right?
Yes.
Could that thing think for itself, or was it just a regular old... How does one go about acquiring a branded helicopter as a supervillain? You know, Thanos, he had to have been familiar with Earth technology and aeronautics, and acquired this helicopter through some nefarious means, and
certainly
then put his name and his likeness on it. So
maybe he but if you're the company that makes the helicopter, you don't know that they probably didn't know that Thanos was a bad guy. Uh-huh. He could have just been John Thanos or something.
Well,
so he's like, hey, hello, I'm. He probably puts on a voice for him, so he calls him up, and they're like, "Hello, Helicopters Unlimited," and he's like, "Hello there, I am John Thanos. I would like to have a helicopter with a large purple individual with the name Thanos embroidered on the side of it." And then Bass looked into JR a little bit at the end there. On the side of it, and the helicopter company, they do it. And then he shows up, and he's a giant purple guy. But, damn it, they paid him the money. They paid them the money, and, they got to do their job. And they do it because they have pride in their work. And they give him his Thanos copter, and he gets foiled. That's what he does. So.
That's right. And he's on the phone. He hangs up. He looks over at Nebula. Do you think they bought it?
Fucking barks.
Okay. Speaking of films that I didn't care for, wasn't sure how to segue there.
Yeah.
Question for both of you, actually. Jenny, you first. Have you ever walked out of a movie?
No, but I did come close on George Clooney's The American. I don't know. Either one of you.
It's real long and slow.
God, it sucks so bad. And, the movie theater is my most favorite place on this earth, and it takes a lot to get me to, leave there, especially after I've paid money, but good God. I sat through that thing looking at John like, what the fuck is happening right now? It's George Clooney. He's awesome. What?
And it's George Clooney as an assassin. It should be even more awesome.
It's a recipe for an amazing movie that just totally shit the bed. And to this day, we still joke about it because I will never get over that movie and how much it sucked.
I don't even mean this as a euphemism, but there's literally, as I recall, correct me if I'm wrong, I remember there being, in my memory, a 45-minute section of the movie that's just George Clooney polishing his gun.
Yes! That is what the entire movie is. And not in the good way, like you said.
Right.
But, in the most boring way.
Right. He's not ejaculating into a bucket.
No,
he's
literally
shining his gun.
Oh, my God.
And,
that's so stupid.
Or cleaning it, I guess, is what they call it. Cleaning a gun. I don't understand how all that works, but all I know is it's boring.
It hasn't. A ridiculous ending that I did not understand. Just no. Sorry, George. I love you, but no. God, I hate that movie. I'm mad right now.
Thank You're getting you mad just for calling it.
And yeah. it's hard for somebody to really, like, it's hard for me to buy that The American would work as, like, a nickname for somebody because, you know, I mean, there's so many.
Yeah, you know, that doesn't mean
it seems
mean
a little
anything.
Generic, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Greg, have you ever walked out of a movie?
Never, because I'm too much of a cheapskate.
Yeah, but you've wanted to.
I've wanted to before. I wanted to walk out. I actually fell asleep during Peter Jackson's King Kong.
Okay.
It aired at my college campus, and I went to see it with my good friend at the time. And we were sitting there, and he wanted to see it, and I didn't. You know, I was kind of like, eh, whatever. But we went and saw it, and I was willing to give it a chance. And boy, about that time that I realized that they were not going to show King Kong. And they were just going to show, you know, Adrian Brody doing things. I was like, well, I'm just going to take a little siesta here. And I fell asleep. And I woke up, and it was right in that scene, if you remember that movie, where Adrian Brody is typing in super slow motion about Skull Island or whatever.
Yes.
And, like, I woke up during that, and I was like, good Lord, what am I watching? And, boy, that movie sucked ass. I'm just going to say it.
Glad it picked up once you were awake, you know. I'm trying to think. I've never walked out during a movie. Wanted to during Infinity War. No. did fall asleep during Ocean's 12. Speaking of George Clooney, right?
Didn't right? What is that? I mean, there's a lots of eye candy in that movie, so...
I like that movie.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't love it, but I like it.
I was... I would have walked out had I been either... Well, I wouldn't have seen it if I was by myself. But if I was with a smaller group, I definitely would have been like, can we get out of here? Because clearly nobody was in for it. We were just kind of like, what did we do? And, you know, you're kind of stuck at that point. So.
You mean you didn't like Brad Pitt leaning on things and eating, like, various.
Well, he does that in every movie. Yeah, I mean, yeah. His move, like, Tom Cruise runs and Brad Pitt eats. I mean, that's just what they do in all their movies. So I just didn't really need it in that one. So it's. Okay, Greg, you mentioned college, and I want to get into this. I want to spend some time with College Greg, if you will. But I don't want to do that just yet. I want to know a little bit more about the young Greg Phillipsian.
When I went to the store with my mother.
That exactly. you know how this goes. Do you have any siblings? It's my first question.
No, I'm an only child.
That's what I thought. Do you wish you had siblings? I ask this as an only child myself, and I always wonder how other people feel about it.
I
wonder that too, you know, about Ethan being the only child.
Yeah, I go back and forth. When I was little, I did want a sibling. And then I reached a point where I was glad that I didn't have a sibling, because when you're on limited means, it means you get more stuff if it's just you.
Yeah.
And things are better for you. And then I kind of reached a point in recent years where I was like, you know, I have to admit, like, I don't wish that I had siblings. I'm happy with how it was now, but I do kind of look at the relationship that some people have with their siblings, and I'm a little jealous of it. And I'm like, man, I kind of wish I had that when I was little, you know. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, I also realized that with our situation, I wouldn't probably have had the some of the fun experiences I had as a kid. If we had had, you know, if I had a brother or sister, so.
That's very selfish of you, Greg.
How could it be? Well, see, you possibly, but it's not that selfish because there's no person there. I'm not like selfish at the expense of a brother or sister because they're only hypothetical. Mm-hmm. My parents did not want another child because I don't know why, but they just didn't want another child, so.
Yeah, I will admit.
Hell, they probably didn't want me, but here I am.
Were you playing, Greg? No.
I'm going to go with no on that.
Same.
I think I actually was, and then it didn't work out for them, so it was sort of like, well, joke's on you.
So I don't know. I like when I was a kid, I really wanted a brother to play with, to watch wrestling with and all that stuff. But then, like, you know, I reached a point where I was like, you know what? I'm good like I am. I have better – what I have now is better than having brothers and sisters because I have friends, and they're like having brothers and sisters, except there's not as many responsibilities related to that. So
yes, yes. And that's sort of where I come at it from too. I both wish I had had siblings or at least a sibling for mm-hmm. selfish reasons – and I'm glad I didn't, also for selfish reasons. So,
right.
Like, it would have sucked in certain respects, you know, just the having to share things of it all. Like, fuck that. but at the same time, now that I'm older, it's kind of like, man, is there somebody who could just kind of share some of the, I don't know, responsibilities that come with...
Right, that's the other aspect. There is a selfish... Child.
Yeah.
Yeah, there is a selfish aspect of that, too, where you're like, you know, I have to take care of my parents. And,
yeah,
you know, I have
person.
Right, the only one that will do it. And so, or can do it. And it's not that I necessarily mind that. It's
right,
just
right.
that, like, it is a burden. And it would be kind of cool to share it with somebody as opposed to owning all of that on yourself, you know? So.
Well, I mean, I have a brother, and... You know, we're sort of estranged at the moment. So, you know, it's not a given that you're gonna have help. You know, when that time comes, you know, it actually might be it might be easier if you were the only one because you don't have to argue with somebody. You know,
true.
About what to do if there's not already clear instructions about what to do. So,
but if you're neurotic like me, you instead argue with yourself.
Well,
instead of being able to channel your energy at another person, you sit there like, well, maybe I should do this. I don't know. You shouldn't do that. And then it's like, you know, and you talk to yourself in stupid voices, and then it's just, it goes nowhere.
Greg, where did you grow up?
Okay, so I was... I did most of my growing up in a little town called Venice, Florida, which is in South Florida between Fort Myers and Sarasota, if anybody out there knows where those places are.
Kind of, yeah.
Down there on the west coast of Florida on the bottom part. And I was born in Mobile, Alabama. That's where I lived for the first 5 years of my life, and then we moved down to Florida where my dad's family is. When I was 13, we moved back to Mobile, and that is where I spent all my high school years. And up
to
this day,
I thought that's where you always lived. See, I'm learning things here.
Yes, I moved back, and so the reason that I sound probably the reason that I sound like this, and I don't sound like this, is because we moved to Florida, and there were a little secret about South Florida. There is a large amount, despite what Jason Sherman might tell you, a large amount of northern extracts that live in South Florida. And so at school, I was mocked relentlessly when we first got down there because I had at age 5, 6, 7, I had a very thick southern accent. Very, you know, I was distinctly Alabama. You know, I sounded a certain way. So after getting made fun of for that for enough time, I realized I would have to adapt. And so I adapted and tried to sound as neutral as possible, which then got whittled away with over the years back in Alabama, high school, college, and all that. And I'm fine with it.
Very good.
So, but yeah, that's my secret origin location-wise.
Okay. And you went to college in Alabama.
I did. Graduated high school in Mobile in 2002 and went to a college I had never heard of before because my only hope to go to college was to get a full paid scholarship as we had no savings. So I wanted to go to the University of Alabama, had since I was a little boy for entirely stupid reasons, football, which had nothing to do with me because I didn't play football. So, they would not give me a full scholarship, and so my options came down to LSU, South Alabama, and what was then called Troy State University. And so I went with Troy because basically they paid me to go to college there. They gave me a grant also on top of my scholarship.
That's the way to do it.
Yeah, so I ended up going to Troy University in Troy, Alabama, a little small town. When I got there, it was still a pretty small university. It's grown a lot since then. And, and I've been there, or I was there for a significant amount of time.
And, we're not going to let that slide either.
So I graduated in 4 years. I graduated on time.
What was your major?
Journalism. I was I was originally a broadcast journalism major.
Oh.
And I thought at the time when I got to college, I was kind of going through this phase where I thought I wanted to be like on SportsCenter. I wanted to be a sports reporter. Mm-hmm. And so I was a broadcast journalism major with a minor in sports information. And so my real secret plan when I left high school, went to college, was I wanted to be a writer. You're gonna love this, guys. I wanted to be a writer, a creative writer for WWE.
Oh God!
Really?
Yes. That actually was my career dream at age, like, how old was I when I learned wrestling was scripted?
Was written?
I realized it was quote. I realized it wasn't real when I was like 5, and then like I probably started understanding the concept of like writers when I was like, I guess probably around 10 or 11. I wanted to be one of the writers for the WWF magazine. I was like, that would be the best job in the world.
Okay,
but then when I got to high school and I really started learning how wrestling worked and the ins and outs of it, then I wanted to be a creative writer, a storyline writer.
Oh no.
I got into e-feds, if you remember those.
Oh,
two.
Oh no! Yeah.
I was a huge e-fed nerd in high school and
like
college.
5 minutes, I'll admit, like literally for a month and a half. Yeah, I was in one.
What is the e-fed?
Oh,
clue
no,
me
don't,
in.
Don't tell her.
Smarten me up, motherfuckers.
Some things must be kept to us.
No,
it's
not all talk and pop.
Okay, so it's. Oh, this is terrible. We'll just have to edit this out.
No.
So it's kind of like a fantasy. It's kind of like the fantasy draft in fantasy sports, but for wrestling. And you join a pretend fantasy federation that has a name like Global Wrestling All-Stars or something. I literally don't remember what the name of the one I was in.
Sounds like you didn't.
Honestly, I would tell you if I did. When I tell you there were so many, like, there were so
there. Yeah, 1999 many. And 2000, it was like you couldn't throw a rock in the void of the internet and not hit an e-fed.
It was basically, everywhere. And, like, some of them were... And Greg, correct me if I'm wrong. Some of them were purely like totally everybody had like made up wrestlers that they.
Yeah, those are actually the ones that I did. Mostly.
Yeah, yeah. And there were others where you could
existing
quote, unquote,
wrestlers.
Draft existing wrestlers.
I'm sorry.
And some were really weird and they had a combination of the two.
Yes, yes. Oh my God, mine was not. I remember it. Shit. Yep.
What about this is not awesome?
Well, and what I would add to what Tim was saying is it was kind of like a combination of fantasy sports and role playing and a little bit of fan fiction as well.
Right.
Because I don't know how yours operated, because there were different types of e-feds. There were those that went on like stats and points and stuff, which I never got into because I never understood it.
I didn't. Yeah, same.
And then there were those that judged you based on your, quote, role plays.
Mm-hmm.
Now, role playing was basically you would have a message board, inevitably, and on this message board, you'd have your weekly shows.
Or an AIM chat.
Yeah. You would have your weekly matchups. And so, like, the commissioner of the league or whatever would say, this week on Saturday Night Showdown, it'll be Frederick Flintstone against, you know... the German Destroyer in a 2 out of 3 falls. And so then you and your opponent would have a week up until that Saturday to write role plays on the message board, and the owner or whatever would decide at the end of that week. He would look at the role plays, who had the best role plays that week, and that person would win that match. If you win matches, you move up the standings. You get fame and glory in the e-wrestling world.
Is this still a thing?
I don't know. Probably.
I'm sure in some circles.
It's not what it used to be. It, like, when Tim says that it was popular, like, it was everywhere on the internet in wrestling circles in 99 and 2. Because you have to – it's hard for people to remember now because people try – I feel like people – I don't know if you agree with this, Tim. I feel like people try to minimize how popular wrestling was then versus now. And, like, it was everywhere.
Yeah. Well, it was much more of a – I don't know. It was on the one hand more popular, but still sort of in its own bubble.
Yes.
Where it was like there are certain people, only certain people like knew wrestling and were really super dialed into wrestling. And there were all these little aspects of the culture that it just bled into. But I mean,
it's almost like it was so popular as a mainstream thing that like, the quote the need for people to the natural need of us to segment ourselves from others led to this massive internet wrestling bubble that formed to like, oh well, we're cooler than these other people that are also watching the same thing that we're watching because we have secret knowledge of it.
Yeah, it was just this weird kind of internet wrestling community carve out sort of deal with.
Yeah,
I mean, this is back in the days of like, you know, message boards were a thing, which you don't really have message boards for anything anymore. It's like all Reddit now and Facebook groups and stuff like that. So, it was just the internet was different then, the culture was different, wrestling had a wider reach, and news groups, God, RSPW on Usenet was such a big deal at the time. And that's where I think a lot of these things came up from. And it was just like, I don't know, that's just such a snapshot of our society that I guess you don't really think about. You just sort of take for granted now that it's like, oh yeah, that was a thing. And you're like, to try to look back on it and break it down, you're like, that was really a thing.
Yeah. Well, I can't hate on my e-fetting too much. Like, admittedly, it's an incredibly geeky thing, but almost everything I do is incredibly geeky.
Sure.
But it also was immeasurably helpful to my writing. It did more to improve my writing, I think, than any of my, academic paper writing stuff ever did, because it forced me to be creative. It forced me to come up with. Because I got so into it that I found leagues that like were really into the writing part, like almost everything else, pretty much everything else was almost irrelevant as to the writing of it. Then I actually was given control of one and forced to write the shows, and then I was like took that really seriously. So like over the course of several years in high school, my writing got better, my understanding of like story structure and dialogue especially got a lot better, and it really helped me become a much better writer going into college doing that stuff. Although it was incredibly geeky and I should have been shoved in a locker for it, probably.
Hey, well, you can't say it didn't serve you. If you got a grant to you got paid to go to school, fuck yeah. So.
Yeah, it was good in that regard, and so it's kind of like a precursor to what I think a lot of people now use fan fiction to kind of help their writing and get better at stuff. And so that was kind of like my version of that, I guess, where I would create characters and like, you know, try to get in their headspace. So yeah, I wanted to write for the WWF to like craft storylines. I wanted to be Vince Russo, bro.
Yeah, you wanted to start out doing the actual movies. Official, not the dirt sheets, but the official WWF and Raw magazine, bro. And then parlay that into to a job backstage and creative, and then take over the business.
That's right.
And then book Viagra on a pole matches.
Damn right. Actually, that's how I would have started. That would have been my first pitch to Vince. Mr. McMahon, I'm pleased to meet you. I know I only have a few seconds, so I'm just going to say Viagra on a pole. God damn it, pal. I like your style.
Oh, so in other words...
I'm just sitting here blown away because, like, I'm super into this idea, and I think we need to bring it back.
Oh, my Lord.
We could start our own Place to Be Nation Pop eFedly.
We can.
You know, the pro boards are back now. I talked about no more message boards. Look what just fired back up.
I'm just saying, everything cycles back around eventually, right?
Bigelow34.proboards.com.
Let's get that.
My favorite thing about the e-fedding was, like, when you would be, we were always in an all original league, and so, like, you had to come up with your original characters, but then new people would join, and they'd create a character, like, my all-time favorite in our league was this dude joined, and he created a character named Cold Hard Killer Kenny. Just imagine who might have been a popular wrestler at that time that had a similar name. Except this guy's catchphrase, instead of that's the bottom line, because Cold Hard Killer Kenny said so. What was it? It was, his catchphrase, I shit you not, at the end of every roleplay, he would have his character grab the microphone from our fake announcers, who always had weird names like Jim Floss and Harry the Prince Lawler. Very creative shit. And he would have to grab the microphone and he'd say, "So what, big whoop, who gives a flying fuck?"
I love it.
So I'm picturing like Stone Cold, and he's like, "If you want me to say so what, big whoop, give me a flying fuck, give me a hell yeah." Oh, Lord, what was wrong with us?
Oh.
And do you know who one of the people was that e-fetted with me, Tim?
Oh, God. Andrew Reich.
No, beyond our bubble, my friend. This is
Was it Conrad Thompson?
Oh, if only. He might have been. I don't know. He might have been Cold Hard Killer Kenny. No, one of the guys in our league was Sean Ross Sapp of Fightful.com.
Who the fuck is that?
He is an increasingly known in wrestling circles dirt sheet writer, basically. Like, he's kind of like become a mini Ryan Satin or I don't know. Not he's not quite Meltzer level, of course, but he's like a mini. I don't know who the hell Wade Keller, I guess. Yes, he's like a David Bixenspan type figure. And so, like, he was in our e-fed and all those years ago.
Wow.
And now he's taken it to become the 7th or 8th most popular wrestling reporter on Twitter.
And you dodged a bullet by not working for WWF Creative.
Probably so. I probably would have been fired and sodomized within a week. So, or maybe not in that order. But in some order.
Yeah. Well.
All the directions I thought this would go in is just like, I'm just sitting here just blown away.
I'm glad.
Just amazing. Amazing. Yeah. How did I not know that? How have we not talked about this in the years that we've been in this group chat and talked about God knows what else?
It's never come up.
It's amazing.
I would have to think.
Poppy Pop is an amazing space to live in.
This is a safe space, too.
It is.
We can talk about this.
I've never, like, just, I can't even believe it.
Let's take a break.
I'm good with that. I'm comfortable with that after busting my e-fed talking cherry.
There we go.
And we haven't even got to the good stuff. Oh, my God.
I know. All right. A lot more to come, folks. We're going to take a break.
Y'all stick around and come right back.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following. Place Food Nation's Justin Rosero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have a ton of great podcasts available to you on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlaceFoodNation.com. And we now offer them to you on two great feeds. On the Place Food Nation Wrestling feed, we bring you the Mothership, the Place to Be podcast, Main Event, Survey Says, Wrestling War Zone, a Monday Night Wars podcast retrospective, No Holds Barred, Jeff Learns Wrestling, and our monthly pay-per-view reaction shows. On top of that, we're also dipping into the vault, re-releasing the entire catalog of Where the Big Boys Play for your enjoyment. And in addition to these full-length shows, we also deliver special network pod blasts on topics old and new.
The Place to Be Nation pop feed is loaded with great content, offering such tremendous shows covering the land of pop culture, such as Geek and Sassy, Talkin' Pop, the Glenn Butler Podcast Hour Spectacular, Sunday Groove, PTB in Play, Freak Out Drive-In, Songs with Friends, Looking Forward, Looking Back, and Lucha Undead, as well as a veritable podcast heaven for comics fans with the Hard Traveling Fanboys, Sellers Points, Conversation Comics, DC Post Crisis Management, Marvel Age, and Marvel Age Masterclass, plus weekly pod blasts that cover the gamut of comic topics. The feed is also filled with insightful sports content, including the NBA team, This Week in the NFL, and more.
And you can find all these current shows, plus archives of our past podcasts, including The Kevin Kelly Show, as well, by subscribing to both feeds on iTunes. And while there, be sure to rate and leave feedback as well. All of these shows, plus others, available at PlayStation.com. We cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, in-depth stretch projects, and more. Be sure to support our site by using PlayStation.com/Amazon while doing your online shopping. And download our free PTB Vintage Vault Refresh ebooks via the links on our site. We also want to thank our friends at Boneheads Wing Bar, ProWrestlingOnly.com, and TheHistoryOfWrestling.com. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr as well. PlayStation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
What the fuck is eggnog, mom? Someone please tell me. What the fuck is eggnog, that yellowy gloop? What the fuck is eggnog, mom? Someone please tell me. What the fuck is eggnog, I haven't a clue. That gloop, that gloop. What the fuck is that? Can't you see? Please tell me. What the fuck is that? Not that yellow. What the fuck is that? Not want someone, please tell me. What the fuck is that? Not that I have a shoes. That gloop, that gloop.
Welcome back to Talkin' Pop, where we're rich, beautiful, and everyone wants to fuck us.
Yeah, they do.
I'm Tim Capel. That voice you heard is Jennifer Smith. We are here with Greg Phillips and left off on a bit of a cliffhanger here, talking about e-feds and nerding out and writing and being in college. And college, Greg Phillips is attending the prestigious Troy University, and he is a journalism major. Now, Greg, sounds like you stuck around old Troy University a little longer than you had to. Was that the deferred life plan? How did this work exactly?
A little bit. See, at some point in college, I had decided that I did not want to be go into broadcast journalism, that my calling was to be a writer, and so I wanted to be a print journalist at that point, again, as a stepping stone to get to WWE.
I see.
So I don't know what I thought in my mind was going to happen. I was going to report on local football teams, and then WWE would hire me. I don't know. But I decided to become a print journalist, and so I worked for our student newspaper, which is where I met many of my best friends in the world that we know here at Place Food Nation Pop. Russell Sellers I met there, Sam Neely, who has got a podcast coming soon to our network, and of course Nick Duke we met on the school newspaper. So met a lot of friends there, ventured out of my shell, because unlike eHarmony, eFeds would actually make sure that you never find love. So or indeed human contact in real life.
Now hang on. Now you say that, and it is true, but you mentioned Nick Duke, and I heard a slightly different story about the meeting of the Hard Traveling Fanboys. Didn't it involve a computer lab
It did. Well, this was actually the circumstances surrounding this, though. This did involve a computer lab. However, it was a computer lab on the opening meeting, I think, of our school newspaper, as I recall. Oh, anyway, I could be misremembering it. We have something called our newspaper was called the Tripolitan, or the Trop for short. No one knows what it means, but we had that as our name, or why we called it that. But we would have this thing called Camp Trop, where people that were coming into the newspaper would show up to school early and have kind of an orientation of here's how you write and become a newspaper person. Not that we knew, but we pretended to.
Yes.
So the center of our journalism department was our computer lab. And so, we had various people wandering around, and maybe this was actually the week of, and there were classes starting already. I don't know, but basically how I met Nick Duke, the computer lab's there. As I recall it, I'm on the phone with my mom, and Nick Duke is preface this, a lot's changed since we left off, Tim. Since we left off in the heyday of e-fedding.
The heyday of the e-fed, yeah.
Wrestling has gone from a colossally popular cultural event that is on the cover of TV Guide when TV Guide was relevant still.
Oh, yeah.
To a thing that is so unpopular that to even utter the fact that you had ever watched it was grounds for a beating. So you just didn't talk about wrestling anymore. Nobody did.
No.
And unless you were online, and then you had to make sure no one saw you talking about wrestling.
And so, this is like what, circa 2000? 2008.
This would have been 2006.
Mm.
Yeah, 2006. So wrestling is no longer popular. I am a wrestling fan. All my friends know that about me. I it's almost the first thing that I mention because I want to get it out of the way, and so they're not surprised by it. Yeah. So I'm walking around, not expecting to find another perk. Because I had been at Troy at this point for 4 years and had never met a person who liked. No, I'll take that back. I'd met one other wrestling fan at the time that I had been there. So anyway, I see sitting in the computer lab a young, thin, full head of hair, doe-eyed, Walter Don Nicholas Brandenburg Duke, sitting at his computer, wearing a Triple H t-shirt.
Heish mesh.
And so I'm talking to my dear old mother, and I'm actually talking to her about SmackDown or Raw or something. She still watched occasionally at this point. Probably The Rock had been on or something, and she was like, hey, I heard The Rock was on there. And I was like, well, sure, he did. And then other stuff happened, too, and then she stopped paying attention. And so I was talking to her about that, and as I recall, I noticed Nick Duke's shirt in the corner, and he heard me talking about wrestling. Mm. And so I walked up to him after he left the lab, and I was like, hey, that's a Triple H shirt. And he's like, yeah, did I hear you talking about wrestling too? And I was like, yeah. And then we kind of like eye each other up, and I'm like, are you a wrestling fan? And he's like, yeah. And there's this tension because as wrestling fans at that time, especially, you have to kind of like feel each other out are you one of those like, you know, I hope Triple H beats the shit out of Shawn Michaels this weekend. Are you that kind of wrestling fan?
Mm-hmm.
Or are you the, I gave it 2¾ stars. Are you that kind of wrestling fan? What kind of wrestling fan are you?
What genre of wrestling fan?
And so we kind of felt each other out, and I think there was a mutual feeling of like, we were both desperate to find other wrestling fans in Troy. And so mutual love. So we got to talking, and he instantly, of course, as I recall, the first topic of conversation was, oh, Hulk Hogan's my favorite wrestler of all time.
Oh.
And he was talking about Hulk Hogan and leg drops and all this shit. And I was like, And I'm taking mental notes on my checklist of like, waiting for him to say, I got to say, all things considered, I hope that John Cena is able to overcome the odds this weekend. I don't know if he's going to be able to. And then I would discard him as a wrestling fan.
Discard him, yes.
He didn't. And so, and he's probably doing the same thing to me. And so I was like, hey, you want to like come over and watch ECW on Tuesday night?
Oh.
Or whatever night it was that it came on. I think it was Tuesday.
This and, is better than any date I ever had in college, by the way.
Yeah. And so Nick comes over. I lived in a house with a bunch of other people, and it was college, and we lived in this old rickety house, and he came over, and we watched ECW in our, as I recall anyway, and our bond was formed then and there in that living room.
As I recall, you both kind of liked it.
Mm-hmm. That's true. That's true. So, I said, what about breakfast at Tiffany's and Drew McIntyre's right after they've had a fight?
Man. So between
that was an insider reference, folks, to when Drew McIntyre and the valet Tiffany had a domestic dispute.
Yes, and to the band Deep Blue Something.
Yes.
They couldn't come up with the something, I suppose. But wow.
Oh.
So the desperation, the sizing one another up, the, mm-hmm. the feeling each other out, it just...
Yeah, filling each other up, even.
My efforts at cruising young men in the computer lab at my university were far less fruitful.
Well, you know, it's all about the approach. It's the eyeing them, but not actually saying anything.
Man.
And just kind of waiting for them to walk in your general area, and then both of you pausing and kind of eyeing each other up, but each socially awkward enough not to actually say anything.
Right, right.
I mean, it's a... little art, Tim.
It's a dance. That, I mean, it's all in the timing. Yeah. It's like wrestling. It's like a good wrestling match.
In a lot of ways, it's, you know, a give and take between the opponents. You know, you have to trust. There's a lot of trust. There's a lot of in and out, if you will.
Right.
A lot of feeling out process.
Right. And I trust the bed breaking sex then commenced in the then teeth shaped studio.
Not yet. I made him wait for that.
Oh,
I believe in waiting. I believe in waiting for common law marriage.
Greg doesn't fuck on the first date. Huh?
Nope, does not.
What a gentleman.
And so, long story short, I stayed at Troy because, like, I was a print journalism major. I did my thing. I was in sports reporting, and then I realized my senior year after interning and having to cover high school sports that coaches are assholes. And so I was like, God, I wanted to cover college and pro sports. And then I learned that that's not how it works. You have to start at high school sports. And then I was like, oh, no, that's not good because I'm not good at that.
That's not
I don't
good.
Like it. And so they were like, hey, what do you, you know, you're graduating soon. Are you going to get a job as a sports reporter? And I was like, oh, God, that's horrifying. And by that point, I had also started doing a little bit of news stuff here and there, and I was starting to kind of get the news itch. So, graduation's approaching. I don't have any job offers lined up. I have no idea what I'm doing with my life. I honestly sit there and I'm saying, what am I doing? And
I know the feeling.
The end of the semester approaches. I feel the weight of my entire family on my shoulders. So I'm the first member of my family to go to and graduate college, and I feel there's all this expectation and pressure on me, and I don't know what to do, and I can't handle it. And I was having a very much an Earl Hebner-like existential crisis, and so at the end of the semester, our professor that was kind of like was our mentor on the newspaper and oversaw us or whatever, advisor, I guess you would say, he pulled me aside. He said, look, we need an editor for next year for the paper. And I would like, you know, do you have a job lined up? I said, no. And he's like, I'm willing to give you this scholarship for tuition. It won't cover everything, just tuition, if you'll come back and be the editor of the paper. And I said, as I recall anyway, I said, well, as I recall, I said, I will do it if you give me a co-editor. And so my friend Kendra, she was the co-editor, and I agreed to do it. And so I went home that summer, and I worked manual labor with my dad all summer doing construction. Hated it. Got in the best shape of my life. And came back that fall and said, I am never doing that again. I've got to figure out what the hell I'm doing. So then I became the editor of the Tripolitan and got really into the news side and ended up falling in love with news, so to speak. And stuck around Troy for another year and a half until I ran out of scholarship money and could not. And my part-time job at the radio station as a smooth-talking DJ was no longer paying the bills, and so I decided I had to, you know, actually get a job.
So you didn't have to take any classes, but were working, like, your job was basically being the editor overseeing the newspaper, and you had a scholarship, right? That was your income kind of thing.
Yes.
That's,
well,
kind of a sweet deal.
Well, actually, as it worked, I did have to take classes because the scholarship.
What the hell were you taking?
Well, here's the thing. What a turn that was. You're a genius. You were an asshole. What are you doing?
Well, so. Because you'd gotten your degree already, right?
Yes, I've got my degree. And so I thought I had a broadcast degree. And I thought, no, I had switched by that point to a print degree, but I had taken all these broadcast classes. And so I said, I'll come back. And what I'll do is, to justify doing this, I will get another degree in broadcast journalism by filling out the rest of these classes that I haven't taken. So I'll have a double degree, I'll be the editor of the Trop, and I'll get more time to figure my shit out. So I come back, and I'm taking random classes. And plus, I get a chance – this is admittedly the cheat part, because I get a chance to take a bunch of classes that I just wanted to take. Mm-hmm. That had no purpose, like Shakespeare. I wasn't going to do anything with that, but I took a Shakespeare class. Mm-hmm. I took novel writing. I took science fiction and fantasy writing.
Out the electives or whatever that. Yeah.
I took kinesiology.
There you go.
I took theories of some shit. I don't know. I took a bunch
theories
of random
of some shit.
Credits. Which was pretty good. So, like, but mainly I took cool, like, English classes that I just felt like taking, and did that for a while, and then when the money froze up, I was taking stuff like, I mean, I was really stretching and taking, like, you know, 17th century history and stuff like that, really just not terribly useful things, and so then I ended up deciding I wanted to be a newspaperman. And
yes, he said it. I was hoping you would say that.
Luckily enough, I became Greg Newspaperman for a while.
Right. For the Dothan Eagle, right?
Yes, which is actually part of our long-term connection, Tim.
Yes, though we did not know it at the time.
No, we had no idea each other existed at the time.
Which is crazy. That was one of the community newspapers published by the holding company that I worked for. I worked for corporate, so I was a suit, and Greg was a grunt.
Grunt
to the ground kind of thing. Well, I was going to be kinder, but, you know. We had similar college trajectories, though. Like, I did the stick-around thing. I went to grad school, but on a grant where they paid me to go to school kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I know.
Yeah, I mean, and honestly, why not do that? Like, in hindsight.
Yeah,
like,
why not?
You know.
Well, a good reason not to is because it's 2008 and the economy bottoms out. And you can't get a job. But, you know, you can't predict these things. I'm not bitter.
No.
I am bitter. so we worked for, in a roundabout way, sort of the same company for a time. Our overlap was not that long because I left what was then Media General, and telling tales out of school here.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't exist anymore, so it doesn't matter.
No.
I left there in 2008, I think.
And that was my first year at the Eagle. I started in January.
So real briefly. I was there until kind of late in 2008, so we had almost a whole year, but never knew each
and
other.
And a year in which we were both receiving paychecks from the Silver Age toy man.
Yes, we were. I don't even know how to describe that reference.
A little inside, I know.
Greg, I want you to clearly, into that microphone, tell Marshall you still love him, even though you don't.
You're gonna tell You old Silver Age toy man, dude. I know you've been building bombs in your free time, bro. I know you've been working on a newspaper industry that's dying on the vine, dude. But I'm going to need you to look into the camera and tell Tim and Greg that you love them, even though you don't, dude.
And he did. Do you miss anything about being a newspaperman, Greg?
I miss the people that I worked with. I miss my coworkers because I was talking with someone who is a current newspaper woman today at an event that I was kind of trying to help put on. And she works in an Eagle now. And I was like, well, you know, I know it's not like it was when I was there. It's much smaller. But the cool thing about working there is all of us had a mutual understanding that we were all in a shitty profession. Right. None of us made any money. Life sucked. So we needed to have a light and fun workplace, and we all had each other's backs. We knew corporate didn't care about us. We knew that the public hated us, so we all had each other's backs. And so there's something freeing about that. There is something fun about that that you don't have really. I haven't experienced in any other job that I've had, and so I miss that. But it was the camaraderie is really the camaraderie and the creative freedom are the only things that I really miss about being a newspaperman. I don't miss the pay. I don't miss the thanklessness of it all. There's a lot of things that are just like negative about that industry that I could get into, but won't. I don't miss the majority of it, but I do miss working around, a lot of cool people that were really talented and better than me at pretty much everything. So that was also helpful because it made me get better at things that I, wasn't any good at. So
I think that's a fair answer. I just would like to hear someone when they're giving either a retirement speech or, even just a going away party to say something like, well, you know what I think I'm going to miss most about this place is the work. I mean, you people are dime a dozen. I can work with individuals like you anywhere I go. There is nothing special or significant about any one of you, but the work is what keeps me going, and that's what I'll really miss.
To tell tales out of skewl, if I were to retire at this moment, I would probably give that speech.
Tim Capel, you're going to give that speech.
One day I will.
Yeah.
Thank you for giving me this watch and slapping me on the ass and saying, hey, a computer took your job, Daddy.
Got to work that in, too. One day. We're not in a position to do it yet, but one day. Oh, all right. Now, something I want to get into, and Jenny, I think you want to get into as well. Let's talk about some vices.
Greg Phillips' vices?
Yeah, Greg is a man of many vices.
Think so?
Miami vices.
Let's talk about all the substances that you do not consume, Greg.
The substance I do not consume.
Can we talk about what happened the first time alcohol crossed your lips?
Well, the real first time or the Nick Duke first time?
Oh,
both.
See, okay,
both of those times.
We're gonna need both.
The real first. Well, okay. If I'm going way back in my life, the very first time I remember tasting alcohol was when I was young and I grabbed my dad's beer can thinking that it was a Coke and tried to drink from it. And I remember thinking it was the most disgusting thing that I had tasted since that time I picked up his other beer can that had cigarette ashes in it. And this was probably, I was probably four or five. Uh-huh. And I remember, and that stuck with me a long time. I was like, why would anyone drink that? It tasted like what I imagined urine would taste like, but I didn't call it urine. I probably called it TT at the time. Because I was a kid. Anyway. Wow. And so, and then like the second time that I remember tasting alcohol, I really didn't after that for many, 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 many years. And then I remember it was, to would have been before right before I went off to college, so 2001 or two, and my uncle's girlfriend at the time, or maybe they married, I don't remember, but she wasn't around long. She was kind of like a what I would consider to be a I'm not going to judge people necessarily, but like she was not a wholesome lady. Okay. She was more of a
she's a fast woman.
Well, a little bit, and then and did not have much of what one would call a conscience about things. And so, I was 17.
She's a devilish woman.
Yeah. I was 17, so it was before my senior year of high school, I guess. We were helping them move into a new place, and in fact, I remember what it was now. It was the weekend of the Invasion pay-per-view, if you remember, in 2001. Mm-hmm. We watched it at my uncle's place, and then we were helping them move stuff. And it was just me, for some reason, there with her, and we were the only ones in the house at that time moving boxes in. And she said, have you ever had, what was it that she gave to me?
She can go in a lot of directions with that.
Right, yeah. No, she didn't follow with relations. She said, have you... Which would have been strange if an actual person said, have you ever had relations?
I would want her to phrase it that way, though. Had she gone that direction.
Let me talk to you about the biology of a relation.
Relations.
She said, have you ever had vodka before? And I said, no. And she's like, do you want to try some? And I said, no, I'm good. And she poured some in a glass, ignoring my protestations otherwise. And stuck it in my chest and said, hey, she said, no, you're going to drink this right now. And I said, I don't want to. I really don't want to. And she said, no, you're going to drink this right now. Drink. And so I grabbed it, and against my better judgment, I drank it and didn't like it at all. And I pretended to like it. I swallowed it, and it burned. And I didn't like it. And she's like, so what'd you think? And I said, oh, yeah, it was good. Because I was afraid she was going to pour more and tell me to try it again if I said no. So that kind of scarred me a little bit, honestly.
It was just vodka in a glass. It wasn't mixed with anything?
Oh, yeah.
Gosh.
And so I was like, the whole thing made me very upset. I was just like, man, that was that wasn't good. So and then there was another party the next year.
That's just cruel.
Where, right before I went off to college, we had a post-graduation party. It was all fun and all that stuff. And then my friend's mom at that time, she still is mom. Not his mom at that time.
His mom at the time. Mom,
and she grabbed me, and she was insulting me for not drinking. Everybody was drinking, and she's like, are you going to have I don't know what it was, a beer or something? And I was like, no, I'm good. And she's like, well, what kind of a man are you? I thought you were going to be a man. You're just a boy. And I'm like, what the hell is that? Are you out of a movie? I remember I actually told her. I was like, are you out of a movie or something? What is going on? I don't understand this. And my friend Thames grabbed me and was like, yeah, let's just, you probably just need to get out of here. And I was like, yeah, probably a good idea. So, the time that you guys are thinking about, we were at a party at my house in Troy, and I grabbed a Smirnoff. I thought at the time Smirnoff was non-alcoholic. I thought it was
practically non-alcoholic, but
whatever you call that. What were those? Zimas or
no?
I don't know.
Duels.
Oh, duels. Yeah. So yeah. I thought it was a gimmick like that. So I grabbed one. I said, what the hell? We were all sitting around in lawn chairs out in the yard with a fire going or whatever, and I'm drinking this Smirnoff, and I remember thinking it tastes like a Sprite. It's pretty much just like a Sprite.
Sure.
Yeah. And somebody walks up to me, and they're like, oh, my God, Greg, you're drinking a Smirnoff? I was like, yeah, what's the deal? And I thought they were screwing with me because my friends have a tendency to take advantage of my gullibility. As I am very easy to fool because I believe pretty much anything somebody tells me. So I was like, I thought they were being sincere and they were screwing with me. And then they were like, and then I found out, or I thought they were screwing with me, but they were sincere that, yes, this was an alcoholic beverage I was drinking. And I finished it, and I was just like, that's it? I didn't like that. I mean,
that's it?
Yeah, it's like it felt like it had kind of a weird. I remember like a weird like sensation in my nostrils or whatever, and that was pretty much all I remember about it. And I was like, I'll just drink a Sprite. I don't really need this. I didn't want to, you know. I didn't have any desire for it. So that was the only time. The only other time. And of course, and I was like aghast at the time. I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't mean to do that.
Aghast.
Yeah, I was like, God, my stars and garters. Heavens to Murgatroyd. So that was that. And I, you know, that was pretty much my last time, as far as I can remember anyway, drinking, because I just didn't want to. And not drinking. I mean, clearly I've had, you know, hydration since then. I drink
well,
right.
Many, you know, Mountain Dew and your, you know, your water and
your water.
Things of that nature.
Yeah. Is this the abstaining? Is this like a just a personal choice, or was there any kind of family history that kind of steered you away from it, or just maybe these overwhelmingly poor experiences that you had?
Right,
right. Yeah.
Which I was unaware of. Where does this stem from?
I think a combination of factors. It's probably like a 3 or 4 pronged attack on my on the path of Greg becoming a drunkard to prevent that from happening. So number one is the family history. Okay. I have neither. My dad was an addict before he met my mom, and I never knew him as that. So I'll just exclude that part of it.
Yep.
But like. My uncles struggle with alcohol abuse. My aunts on my dad's side struggle with alcohol abuse. My dad's father, who I never met, was an alcoholic who abandoned his family and died of, you know, complications related to his alcoholism. I would hear these stories growing up about all these people in the family who, you know, were wasted. And my dad would have, you know, he would drink, but he would drink responsibly. He would have a beer once in a while. He would have a beer with dinner, and then, you know, with but his friends were over, they might have a couple. And that was pretty much it. My mom never drank at all. So, I wasn't around anyway. So, it was the combination of their example of like, okay, they're normal functioning people and they're the only people in our family that are, everybody else is a freaking disaster. And the common denominator was largely anyway, was substance abuse of some kind.
Yeah.
So I think that was one aspect. And then another aspect was, undeniably there was a religious aspect to it as a kid, because my great grandmother was a big factor in my life, and she would always preach against the ills of drinking. So that was instilled in me from a very early age. And then there was, as you mentioned, the negative, extremely negative experiences that I had with him, in high school or end of high school, beginning of college, that really like steered me away finally, I think, for like it created a negative connotation to me. And then it was also kind of like there was never this want. Mm-hmm. Like I don't know why. I really don't know why, but I've never had the desire to do it. I've never once that I can remember in my life thought to myself, man, I would love to try, you know, whiskey or whatever. It's never occurred to me to even want to. So it was, for me, it was not something that ever registered. It was not something that ever, I wasn't concerned with trying to fit in really. And I wasn't concerned or so that the peer pressure aspect of it didn't register with me. And then the, you know, social aspect of it didn't register with me either. And I'm still not sure why, but it just never, I don't know. I just never really cared to venture to try. And there was an aspect of like, I always feared, because I've always had kind of a bad experience when I'm around. I feel bad when I'm around people that highly respect, that I'm friends with, and they're not acting like themselves for one reason or the other, whether it be medical or alcohol induced or whatever. And it makes, I've always been like, I never wanted to lose control of myself in that way and say something I didn't want to say to hurt anybody's feelings, to do something stupid that I would regret, you know, things like that. So I'm a person that is largely ruled by his fears, and I could never push that fear away, even if I got through all my other issues. So,
So sounds like a bell best left unrung, easy to leave unrung in your case. I guess it just surprises me that you're not. It's going to come. I'll phrase it this way: not only are you not insufferable about it, your sobriety, I mean, and that a lot of people who are, let's say, straight edge, right? which you're not even identifying as, you're a sober person, are just, that's kind of their whole existence, or a big part of their identity, right?
Right. I'm not drawing X's on my hand or anything.
Yeah, and I mean, I get it. If that's what you need, yeah. If that's what you need, and if that's what works for you, then cool. And there are probably reasons for it, but you were kind of the first person I ever met who was just kind of casually, no, I don't drink, and it's not my religion. It's just
right
my preference, you know. Yeah. And yet you have friends who, let's face it, are kind of drunken imbeciles, such as myself. And
I wouldn't classify any of you as imbeciles.
Well, we tie one on, I'll put it that way. And
Nick, when he gets drunk, I will call him to his face an imbecile, but the rest of you know. The rest of you are not.
You just call us karaoke partners.
Right.
I guess my point is that not only are you not insufferable about it, but I sort of have more respect in that, I don't know, things that you say sort of carry more weight in a sense that, like, if I was drunk and acting like an idiot and you, like, called me out on it, you know, just as a hypothetical, I would kind of be like, oh, shit, and really check myself a lot more than maybe I would that coming from somebody else. And by the same token, if I am trying to call someone else out on their behavior, I think they'd have every right to look at me and be like, fuck you, Charlene. You know, like,
what the fuck do you know about fighting?
Exactly.
So, I'm going to interrupt you right here and say that the times that I've been inebriated around Greg Phillips, I would venture to guess that he has had an absolute fucking blast.
And that's
so
great. Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. I'm like, you know, is that true or is that not true?
Yeah, that's true. That's true. It's all contextual. It really is. It comes down to some people become worse people when they drink, and some people remain the same when they drink. And
or
you know,
become
just,
better.
I suppose there are those who become better. I don't know that I've encountered anyone that I would say becomes better
you
because
have.
Of it. Maybe I have. But yeah, it's it's fun. Yeah, we have a blast. Yeah, I used to have major hang-ups about it when I was in college. I didn't want to be around it at all when I was in early college, especially, and even probably late college. But like, I got to a point where I just became very comfortable with myself in that regard, anyway, and comfortable in the people that I knew that it wasn't going to be an issue, that it wasn't going to be the aunt trying to force you at 17 to, you know, do this, you know,
so, as hell,
cause there was a lot of that. I used to genuinely fear that the people that I considered friends and that I trusted were going to turn around and do that kind of stuff to me that make me the, you know, the laughing stock because I wouldn't do this thing. Once I got to the point where that wasn't a concern anymore, it was a lot easier for me to open up and just be like, you know, people can do what they want to do. I mean, I don't have any issue with it. It's, you know, Jenny can attest, we have a good time at the karaoke festivals at the
festival.
the watermelon crawl.
The watermelon crawl at the Duke Depot. What a fascinating place that is. And it's all good. And I appreciate your words, Tim. I have great respect for all of my friends here in our group, and so all of you. So yeah.
All right. Well, I've been sitting here waiting.
Yeah. Please.
Opportunity to talk to you about what led us to this episode of Talk of Pop, which was a guest appearance on Geek and Sassy, in which you referenced an ex-girlfriend and her unique beliefs.
Oh my.
So, I mean, you didn't really give much away, except for, I remember, 9/11 truther, conspiracy theorist, and then I stopped you and said, save it for Talking Pop, Greg.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what I need to know about now.
Okay. What do you want to know?
I want to know the whole thing. Everything.
Oh my God. So... This is not my proudest venture in life. So my romantic history has largely revolved around either pursuing the unobtainable or taking an going after incredibly. I'm trying to put this. Going after a certain extreme of caution and safety and, like, you know, no challenge there to my existing belief structure or my nobody that was going to be a risky person, shall we say, that will be a you know, no
one's going to change you as a person.
Yeah, yeah, very good. Thank you. I was dying on the vine there.
Same. It's okay.
So I was very, say, risk averse in that department for many, many years. And a few years ago, a friend of mine, a mutual friend of mine in Nick's, who has a rather unique career choice, people that know us can read between the lines and probably figure this out who it is, but which should have been my first indicator that this person was trying to set me up. So he wants to set me up on this double date because he's trying to pursue this other girl. And so he said that her friend wants to meet me. And at the time, I'll be honest, I was pretty desperate. So I was like, you know what? I'll give it a try, not expecting anything. So we go, and we go to, like, Red Lobster, I think it was. And so I meet this girl, and we kind of hit it off. I didn't think much of it, really. I mean, we hit it off fine, but, I was just goofing around with my friend, largely, and, doing the whole jokes and whatnot. And so I leave.
70 inappropriate jokes in my head right now.
Mm-hmm, same.
Yeah. So we start, later that night, she has me on Facebook, and then she starts messaging me, he messages me like a day or two later. He's like, hey, she won't quit talking about you. And so this is a weird situation for me. My entire life, I had never been in a situation where a girl had that's not accurate. I'll be called out if I say that. I had only... once before been in a situation where a girl had actively been pursuing me, like, without me indicating that I was interested. And so I didn't know how to react to this. I was like, well, this is interesting. I'm going to pursue this, of course. So I did. And it was fine. It was good, in fact, for a little while. And then it wasn't. then it was bad. Then it was, she dropped off the face of the earth, in fact. And it went from, like, she wouldn't leave me alone. And then it became like I could not contact her. She wouldn't answer messages. Not only should I answer messages, it would not even do the little thing where you'd send a message and it shows the face pop up to say that they've received it. It wouldn't even happen. It just wouldn't. It wouldn't be received. Phone calls ignored. Nothing.
She blocked you.
So I was like, "Well, no, she never blocked me because I could still send the messages." But like, it wouldn't. Like, there was no blockage. We were still friends on Facebook. Well, there may have been blockages. I can't say. We did a Red Lobster. But,
I think that'll open you up.
Nothing that can't be solved with Dr. Tobias Owen fungus, in fact.
Yes.
But I can't imagine why she would not want to talk to me, by the way, after I talk about blockages and colon cleansing. But
over
so,
dinner.
So I'm pretty pissed at this point. I'm like, who is this person? Like, I didn't ask to be with her, you know, so... She contacts me. She apologizes. She goes on this long spiel about her history of issues and you know, abandonment issues and all this stuff. And I was like, okay, well, sure. That's I get it. I'm sorry. So I apologize for some reason, as I often do. and I apologize for like, oh, I jumped to conclusions and all this stuff. And she apologized, and we started back, and that lasted for about 2 months. And then it was the same deal. And then I was like, all right, I'm done this time. I'm not going to respond to this person anymore. And then she reached out to me after the holidays. Or no, I reached out to her after the holidays because I was in a very like Christmassy, forgiving mood. I was like, I've got to get this off. I'm so negative. And I was like, I don't want to hold negativity towards someone. It's not good. So I reached out and I said, hey, just want to let you know I forgive you, and I hope you had a good Christmas, and that was the end of it. And so I was, you know, I was done. Well, then she starts messaging me over the next few days, and we meet up and just hang out, and then we're just friends for like a couple months, and then we start dating again, and then we really start dating. And
what
then
does that
like,
mean? What's the difference there?
Well, like just like I don't know. I mean, it wasn't just like, hey, we go on a date once in a blue moon. It was like, we hang out a lot, like a lot. And so
a relationship a lot.
Yeah, sure. We were in a relationship. That's fair to say. And, to the degree that like, you know, we were, you know, she helped me put together my Christmas gift for my mom. You know, we were doing all this crazy, like, you know, just, long time relationship stuff together. And this whole time, by the way, that we're doing this, I'm not letting anybody know except my parents and my family, because I was afraid everybody was going to judge me for going back with her, because people had known, like a few people had known, very few people had known that like we were seeing each other in the first place, and then it was not good. It did not go well the first time. So I was worried that like people would like, you know, think less of me if they knew that I was back with her. But I was really enjoying it. It was going well. And she was talking about marriage and kids and stuff. I wasn't ready for all that. But like she was sending me messages about this over Christmas break and everything last year. I work at a university, so I still get a Christmas break, which is kind of cool. anyway, we come back and we're, you know, this year is goes the way it goes. And just randomly, it felt like to me, like it goes from being fine to being not good at all. And I get this like phone call. You guys know about this, I think, the 4.5 hour phone call.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah.
And this is, by the way, I'm moving. So this is like the night before I have to move. My family's coming in to help me move. And I'm up like till 2 o'clock in the morning listening to her manifesto about how she has come to a new season in life and it was time to move on and spread her wings and leave the city that we were in, Dothan, and go to New Orleans. And I said, hey, that's fine. That's I get it. You should do that. You should, you know, pursue that if that's what you're interested in. I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to be anybody's anchor tying them to this. And then she was like, you know, she would continue over explaining it and everything. And then I got, I was like, I get it. You know, you're going to New Orleans. I understand. And then like I got, you know, I got upset and I was like, well, you know, it would have been nice to know weeks ago before I didn't go to WrestleMania solely because I didn't want to hurt your feelings because you wanted to go to New Orleans and I told you I couldn't go at the time. And now Nick's offering me to go and I would like to go and I actually have the time, but I'm not going to do that because that wouldn't be fair to you. Well, it would have been nice to know that you were going to give me this manifesto just a few days later. But and I said that and I shouldn't have said it. But I said it.
That's pissed. Accurate as fuck.
And so I was bitter about it because I was like I really wanted to go, but I had told her before that I couldn't go to New Orleans because I didn't have the money. That was before this free ticket offer came up, and I was like, well, fuck. And so we broke. We didn't really even officially break up. Like she ended the conversation and saying, "I'm just letting you know what my plans are. That I'm planning to go to New Orleans. I want you in my life. All this other stuff. I'm leaving the ball in your court." And I said, "Okay, I'll get back to you after I move." So I moved, and then I say, "Okay." So I send messages or whatever, and then she starts that ignoring stuff again. And I don't hear from her for 2 weeks. And it's like, and so I'm telling you, and during this 2 week period, I do a lot of soul searching. And I come to the conclusion over long, arduous conversations with the people that I look to the most for guidance, people like my father, people like Nick Duke. And after long and arduous conversations and soul searching, I come to the conclusion that, A, I should probably tell people that I know that I've had this relationship. B, I am done with her. I need to cut it off because I just can't deal with this anymore. My mental health, it's just not good. And so I give her one last chance, and I say, I call her on a Sunday, and she ignores my call. The instant, like, you know, the ring twice and then go to voicemail.
Yep.
And I leave a message. I never hear back from her. That Friday morning, I send her, that Thursday night before I go to bed, I send her a message. And we have our Troy University commencement ceremony the next day that I have to cover. And I say, if I don't hear from her in the morning, I am deleting her from Facebook. Not from Facebook. I can't do that. I don't have the power. But from my Facebook friends list.
Well, yes.
If I had the power, I would, but or would have anyway. So I get up the next morning, never hear from her, gone. Okay, she's off. Well, I begin a long trip to South Florida with my family, my mom and I going down to visit my dad. Long story there, whatever. So we go down there and we visit and hang out. And about the time that I get there, I get a message from her responding to my message from 2 days earlier. And it's like, it's not even like a new message, like, how's it going? It's responding to a question I'd asked her 2 days earlier, like, how was your day or something? She responds 2 days later as, it was fine, how's yours?
Oh my God.
And I'm like, I just ignored it. I never responded to it.
Good.
And so I was done with her at that point. Months pass. And then suddenly in July or August? I get a message from her again saying, and this is exclusive info for Talkin' Pop.
But, oh,
I get a message saying,
sure, the tape machines are rolling. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Some kind of message saying something like, hey, I hope the move is treating you well. I just want to say that I hope life is going good for you. And I got this message during, oddly enough, our fall commencement ceremony, which I was covering. And I was like, I didn't know how to respond, so I just ignored it for then. And she messages me back like 3 hours later and says, "All righty then." And so then I responded, and then I was like, "Sorry, I wasn't intentionally ignoring it. I was covering this thing at work." And so I was like, "Well, you know," I tried to explain. We kind of fell off. I tried to get a conversation with you going just to part us on good terms, and I couldn't get anything from you. And she's like, well, if you'd like to meet up, I'm willing to do that to talk. And so we did. We met at a bookstore in Dothan and just talked. And, you know, we didn't really confront things as we should have. So she came up to Troy like a week later. We met at the Walmart and just hung around and talked a little bit about what had happened. And I kind of fell for the bullshit again about she was on medication. And the medication was causing her to act this way because if she was on ADD medication or something. She got off of it, and suddenly she was feeling happy and good for the first time in a while, which may have been true. I don't know. But so we agreed to go to see Venom together when it came out. No Venom fucking was done in the process.
Man.
The I'm not going to indicate whether that was a motivating factor for my agreeance to this, but we go to see Venom, and it's fine. I get, you know, the movie's good. I enjoyed it, and we had a the movie part was fine. Dinner beforehand was not so good. We ate at this steakhouse, and she was on just this weird like kick. I don't know what it was about, like my fashion choices and stuff. Like, you know, I was just dressed like, you know, I was wearing a t-shirt and jeans or something. And she was like, we need to get you on Queer Eye so we can, like...
Oh, boy.
And I was like, I don't think I'm going to do that. She's like, why? And I was like, well, I just don't really care what people think about how I dress. I just don't care. And she's like, well, that's just because you've never tried to dress up. I was like, no, I've dressed up. I just don't like it. It's not me. I don't like wearing ties and all that stuff. It's like, well, you need to try it. And I was like, no, I'm good. I'm really good. I can promise you I'm good how I am. And, anyway, it was just really not good. It was just kind of weird. And then after the movie, we sat in her car and talked.
A little judgy for a reconciliation sort of
thing. Yeah, I didn't really get it. She said later on that she was just joking about all that. She's like, you know, I was just joking, right? And I was like, I guess. But we sat in her car and talked for like 2 hours about nonsense, just whatever. And then we're just sitting there, and there's like this, I'm trying to remember how we even got on this. There's like this hotel in front of us, and it's like got this like crumbling facade a little bit. And then she, we're talking about, I might have made a joke about something related to the military. No offense to our military brothers and sisters out there. It wasn't anything like that. It was just some kind of goofy joke that I would tell. And she was like, oh, by the way, I dated a guy that was in the active duty military when 9/11 went down. And you know that was an inside job.
Oh, no.
And I thought she was joking. And then I looked at her in her eyes, and I know her well enough to know when she is or isn't joking, and she was not joking about this. And I thought to myself, oh, no. And instead I said, oh, really?
Oh, really? Dude, no.
And this became, well, you know that there's no way that those airplanes would have exploded in such a manner that they did in the building, and that it would have caused the building to implode the way that it did. That's just not... You know, mm-hmm. Do you really think that's possible? He told me how it was done, that it had to be bombs planted inside the building that caused it to do this. And I said, and I didn't say anything. I said, huh. And she was like, she goes on to explain that she's not a conspiracy theorist, you understand? She just believes that, quote AJ Styles, there's something to it. And there are... She says, well, there's just some that I do believe in. And because he said that, like, she's like, it's true. It's a fact. It can't have happened that way. It cannot have happened the way that they showed us on TV. The footage was either doctored or it was done in such a precise way to make it look like one way. But it just didn't make any sense how that whole thing went down. And then I said, she got done with it and she just looked at me and she goes, what do you think? And I said, I mean, I remember this. This is not me sometimes I will selective. Everybody does this selective memory and all that of how you react to situations. I know what I said because I said, well, I don't necessarily believe in all that, but, you know, to each their own. To mm-hmm. which she responds, don't you fucking judge me. And I wasn't judging you, but I was. But I said, I wasn't judging you. I had done nothing to indicate that I was judging her, even though I was.
Even though you were, sure.
And so she says, and then she gives me, what was the other one? 9/11 was an inside job, and then the other... No, was it the moon landing? I don't think it was the moon landing.
Dinosaurs.
It
wasn't saying,
what was that?
Dinosaurs. Some people don't think dinosaurs were real.
Oh my god. Still?
I know somebody like that who you say, you know, you can tell when they're like I could never tell when this person was joking when they would say these things, and I was like, is that a thing? And apparently it doesn't have quite as much support as some of the other theories, but
I think I remember what it was. I think it was and this is the most random one. I think it was David Koresh. I think she thought that the Waco thing was all a setup.
Oh. Like, wow. Okay. That's good.
I
guess if this is coming from the active duty military guy who...
Right, he would
know. Yeah,
he right?
definitely knows.
Some kind of ideas about these things.
Apparently he knows a lot about architecture, too.
Or, yeah, and engineering.
So, anyway, this was a horrifying experience for me, you understand, because I'm still very attracted to this woman, but, like, I was like, I got home that night, and I was like, I've dated her for a year and a half, and not once did that ever come up.
Didn't she believe
that 9/11 was an inside job, and now randomly... Sitting there staring at a building, a nondescript building, it comes up that 9/11 is an inside job. And then that's the point when I realized, what the fuck is wrong with me?
With you?
Well, for even associating. For
entertaining.
Didn't know.
That's true. And she is just as like, I think one of the things that I loved about her for a long time was that she was so different from anyone I'd ever pursued or been in a relationship with or wanted to be in a relationship with. She was reckless and wild and profane and all this other stuff that, like, I guess I found it exciting at first. It was like, she's really I thought I could, like, maybe rub off on her a little bit, so to speak, and she could, you know, maybe make me get out of my shell a little bit. But over the course of time...
Especially watching Venom.
Over the course of time, I realized that, ultimately, I was around a crazy person. And, that's not good. So, anyway, that's my crazy ex story. And, you know, who knows which way the future lies.
So you just left it at that? Like, you guys don't talk anymore?
Or? We just, so she did the vanishing thing again after the Venom incident, and I was wanted...
Let's
refer
to it as the Venom incident, please.
Yes, please.
I think Guns N' Roses actually recorded an album called The Venom Incident.
The Venom Incident.
But, I still would like to have a conversation and just say, look, it's not good for us to see each other ever, and I don't really want to be friends either. And so it sounds harsh, but like I want to be nice because, you know, I really don't like to hold on to negativity, and I like to, and I don't wish ill will towards her by any means, because she's not, you know, as for all of her quirks, she's not, I don't think she's a bad person. I think she's just, you know, she's just not for me. And so, and, you know, kind of the conspiracy theory stuff is dumb. So I would like to have a conversation. But at the same time, I kind of don't now because I think I finally, for real, have gotten just over it at this point where mm-hmm. I'm ready to move on and, you know, go down different avenues, i.e. not try to find an extreme either way. So.
Mm. Wow.
What say you, Jenny?
I mean, like, kayfabe Jenny can say, like, funny
oh,
shit
and,
you know, make fun of her, and then, like, shoot Jenny is like, well, she's mentally ill, like, I can't, like, make fun of her.
That's a fair point.
And it's Greg, so, and he's, like, the best person I know, and so.
I always look at it as, when it comes to someone who is mentally ill, or potentially mentally ill, you know, extend all the sympathy in the world, of course, you know, get the help they need, but I sort of, like, personally have to draw the line at once somebody starts visiting their issues, let's say, on other people in a way that's really harmful. And they may not even know they're doing it, granted, or recognize that, you know, it's a toxic relationship, it's toxic behavior or whatever, but still, it doesn't mean that you have to tolerate that. So
what also I find all the disappearances questionable. You know, like why just you know.
So the excuse on the disappearances is multifold. It is the I'm going through issues. It is the medication. And then it is the my phone doesn't show messages properly. which I don't believe that.
No.
I'm not gullible. I was gullible enough to believe it the first time. I'm not gullible enough to believe it multiple times. And so, it's – and I don't I think that there are deep-seated mental issues there, but I don't know that for a fact.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the other thing that happened that I kind of skipped over is my friend that initially introduced us, who is himself unreliable at times, but is a good, ultimately a good person deep down. When me and her split after our big blow up in the spring, the 4-hour conversation and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I had a long conversation with him like the next week, and I had not told him about any of this stuff because there was a long story there where I just didn't feel comfortable talking about any of the stuff regarding her. So we talked, and he began telling me about things that he had heard because his live-in girlfriend at the time, was best friends with her. And she would come over, and they would talk about me. And so he would say things that he had heard from her perspective about things that had happened in our relationship that never happened.
Oh.
That, like, were not even close to the reality of what had happened.
That's a giant red flag.
Such as, I wouldn't shut up about marriage, and I was trying to move the relationship too fast and talking about kids and marriage, and I was moving things too fast for comfort, and I just needed to stay casual like we had been. When, in fact, I had the receipts, as I told him at the time, I became furious. I said, dude, I've got every message she sent me from the time we met each other, where she's back in November. You find how many times I mentioned the word marriage. Whenever she would bring it up, I would ignore it. I would change the subject. Kids? I damn sure didn't mention kids. Mm. So, like, it never got to that point for me because I never felt like I could trust her. So, like, to that degree. So, like, the fact that I heard that, like, okay, I'm saying all these things that never happened, that I know that she's attributing things to me that she had done and said. I was like, that's really not cool. And no. Then there was like, there was a time where like I had brought her, she was sick. And so I had asked her when we were on the phone, like, well, do you want me to bring you any medicine? And because I was just hanging out at my apartment. She's like, no, I'm fine. I'm just hungry. And so I said, well, I'm coming over. I'm going to bring you some food. What do you want? And she said, no, don't do that. So I was like, okay, I'll do it. And she said, oh, that's so nice. So I go out, and she says, she had said like the week before just that she was, what happened? She had something about, something came up where she wanted something from McDonald's, basically, is what came up on this occasion. And so I go by McDonald's, I pick her up something to eat, I bring it to the apartment, and she's sick, and it's all good and everything. And I was like, well, I hope you get the feeling better. So that's that. From my friend's perspective, what he hears is I refused to go get her medicine because I was too lazy to go out of my way to get it, and instead just wanted to bring her McDonald's food. So, and I don't know, again, I don't know if this is exaggeration. I don't know if this is how it went down. All this stuff going down was like, this was what really like got me to my point over the summer where I was done with it before I foolishly entertained messages again. So, so I don't know what the deal is, but I think there are issues there. I mean, we all have issues, but it's, you know, whatever.
Do you think that her issues would involve listening to this episode and then, like, tracking Tim and I down and murdering us in our sleep?
I genuinely hope she doesn't listen to this episode because I feel awkward even bringing all this stuff up. But you guys know it's like pulling teeth to get stuff like this out of me. I don't like talking about stuff. I didn't even talk to Nick about this for a long time. You know, it's. I hope. I don't think that she would ever listen to this. Really.
Yeah, I'm good with it. What else have I got going on?
I love you for that.
I will add that closure is overrated. It's, I mean, yeah, ideally great, but with the history y'all have had, it just, I don't know, there's a part of me that just believes the whole concept of closure with especially a romantic relationship is just an idea that we have that we want our lives to conform to this kind of expectation or particular narrative that doesn't necessarily track in real life. And as much as we want that for ourselves, this idea of closure, we never really perfectly get it. So just write this one off. You know, like if you're just, done, be done. Don't worry about the whole letting it end the way that you think it needs to or should end. Just if it's done, it's done. Fuck it.
And there's the irrational part of me that I've candidly discussed this with Nick, but I'll say it because I feel like I can trust you guys and probably can't trust the listening audience, but fuck them anyway. So, just kidding, everyone out there. You're all good folks, I'm sure. You know, there's a part of me that was like, you know, I'm 34 years old, and like, you know, I am not a well-off individual. Like, I don't have much going for me, really, in terms of money and looks and all that stuff. So it's like, personality is all I got. And like, even that, as I get older, it's going to be reduced by the probably early onset dementia and things like that. So I probably, you know, this might be my only shot, so I better make this work, you know? But then it's gotten to a point where I'm like, you know what? I just got to say, fuck you, Charlene, and move on.
Yeah. No, I understand.
Oh, wow. It's,
on the one hand, you're like, oh, I'm too old for this, but on the other hand, you're like, I'm also too old to, like, keep doing it.
Keep doing it, to keep trying. Like, you know, there's only so many fish in the sea that I can pursue for years and not actually pursue. So, but I can Facebook stalk.
Yeah. Well, we wouldn't know anything about that.
No, not at all.
Okay. I think we've learned a lot.
We have learned a lot. So many things.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything else we didn't get to?
Oh, gosh. I don't know.
I feel like we could keep this going easily, but there is a finite limit to, I think, what a podcast can be.
Yeah, and how much unburdening you can do in one session.
And I've probably already gone way too far with this and am already regretting it. But but it's too late now. So
yeah, sure is. Sorry.
On that note. Okay. If there are no further questions for Greg. Greg, do you have any questions?
Thank you for your soul, Greg. Thank you. Yes,
you may have a guest now.
I mean, you never know. Your story could help somebody. It's freshly laundered.
I had it pressed. Here's your soul.
And the worlds that you've opened as far as eFed and, like, crazy bitches, it's just... You could help so many people. You don't even realize.
Well, in a weird way, it was therapeutic for me as well to talk about some of this to friends and maybe give some insight as to why I am the way that I am. And it probably all goes back to that initial question that Tim asked about, do I wish that I had siblings? If I did, I may not have made some of the decisions that I did.
Full circle. We like it. We're here to help. Yeah.
Wow.
Also, eggnog. I like eggnog. I always have drank the non-alcoholic eggnog.
Okay.
What is even the point?
Well, it's sweet. It has a unique taste.
Yeah, it's seasonal. You know, you want to get in the spirit, and it makes you feel nostalgic.
I will admit that my taste for it has diminished in recent years. Like, it's changed. When I was a kid, I loved it. Mm-hmm. And now I'm like, I bought some last year put it in my fridge. And whenever I would drink it, it was like a challenge to even get through.
Yeah.
Right.
It's really very rich. I mean,
yeah, it's so rich that it's almost uncomfortably rich. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's frothy and chunky and chunky. Just no, not chunky. That's a bad word.
How long
thick, that might have been your problem.
It's thick semen-like.
Yes.
And although there are some differences between eggnog and semen.
What?
Well, one is produced from a penis, and the other is semen. The main difference is eggnog cannot birth small creatures from it that I'm aware of.
Well, it can if you make some bad decisions after drinking some.
Oh, yes. Decisions like going to watch Venom with,
That's right.
Venom Fucker is anonymous.
I'd rather drink semen. All right.
Same. who is your favorite guy in sweatpants? No.
Who's your favorite guy in sweatpants, and why is it Tom Zink?
Why is it Mick Foley?
Hey, so. Yeah. Never mind. I shouldn't.
No. You can't wave it off now. What were you going to say?
This is this is bad, though. This is not a good thing at all. I
this
was
is
ask,
bad.
How
what,
do you think Tom
show?
Zink really died?
How do I think he really died?
Yeah, because no one's ever said. His cause of death was never revealed.
Guysinsweatpants.com?
Yeah.
No, that's not how he died, I'm sure. But, like, I don't know. Lived. Like, they just never said. Like, was he hung? Was he, like... Well, no,
was
no. We know he was hung. Was he hanged? Was he, was he shot? We don't know.
From arterial sclerosis and cardio... whatever the fuck.
Really? Whatever. Yeah. So it is known? I
Heart
just never
issues.
Knew it?
Heart issues, yeah.
How have I lived this long and not known how Tom Zink died?
That's, Google you know what, Jenny? Man. That's code for he ruptured his, carotid artery with a belt that he was hanging from during an erotic
while masturbating. Yes,
yeah,
that's what I was getting at. Or was it like Rick Rude, where he died trying to inject his penis with steroids, allegedly.
Oh.
Are you fucking serious?
No, well, sort of.
No, well, sort of.
There are lots of outlandish, in my opinion, rumors about how Rick Rude died.
He is not alleged to have died from... Yeah, he's not alleged to have died from that. It's just more of a day-to-day activity that he needed to do.
Yeah, and the theory that Rob
Which I'm
Van
sure
Dan
did not
said,
contribute to his living a long life.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody said that he was injecting this stuff into his wiener because it had stopped working on account of all the other drugs he was taking. And so this particular thing led to him passing away at an early age.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, that was grim.
It was.
Because his dick was so shriveled.
It's really sad to think about.
He was as shredded as his body was when you think about it.
He was a man known for being ravishing, and yet at the end of his life, he could not ravish anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Allegedly. I'm not... Listen, everybody has to make their own personal choices. Choices such as shooting steroids into their erect penis.
I'll sing my version of his theme song in karaoke if you can get me to that.
Yeah. I wondered, when we were going to do this, if Greg's goodness could outweigh Tim and I's
debauchery,
dumpster trash version of ourselves. It's like complete fuck shit chunks. What do you think? What's the...
The best, you were wondering if the best version of a person could overcome the worst possible version?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I think, we just kind of dragged Greg down to our level, and I think that's been therapeutic for him.
It's not you guys' fault or anything. I wasn't sure how to say that. You guys is your it's a weird
use guys.
Use guys. It's your guys.
Yeah. Isn't that a Todd Weber pet peeve? Is you guys is the one that he hates, right?
One of mine is alls I know, which I say ironically a lot.
Uh-huh.
CM Punk says that a lot, by the way. Anyway, it was more my fault for bringing up Rick Rude's penis and Tom Hanks' death and all that. It was not necessary,
that's
really.
That's true. Yeah, we were ready to wrap it up until you...
I'm sorry.
No, I'm glad we didn't, though. That said, I guess we should wrap this one up.
Yeah, Greg. Anything you want to plug? Any social whatevers?
Yes, if anyone would like to follow me, they can go to twitter.com/gphillips, GPHILLIPS, 8652. Why 8652? Because that was the email address I had at Troy, gphillips8652, when I was a student, and I just used it for my Twitter account. And they can read all about wrestling and comics and some football stuff. And if they want to join our Place of Nation Comics Facebook page, we really like to get people on there. That's fun. A lot of good stuff there. Just type in Place of Nation Comics on Facebook and you'll find us. And Hard Traveling Fanboys every week right here on Place of Nation Pops. We will be unveiling this week. I don't know when Talking Pops going live, but this week, as we're recording this, we will be unveiling the Pitches podcast for the...
Oh, God. Oh, I forgot that was happening.
The third biennial Peter David Memorial Fantasy Comic Book Draft presented by a hypothetical non-rotational online DC Comics Unlimited subscription service.
Very good.
It was certainly a unique night.
And
podcasting and debauchery and everything in between. And newcomer Mitch Oaken joined our usual crew for a fun excursion. So be sure to tune into that. And December is Aquaman month, or Aqua month, if you will,
Aquaman.
For the Aquaman with the HTF show, we'll be reviewing several Aquaman trades, an Aquaman animated movie, and we'll be concluding it the month with a review of the Aquaman live-action film. We're probably going to have the manager, Todd Weber, join us for at least one of those episodes, so stay tuned for that.
Awesome. I will. Also, Greg was on an episode of Geek and Sassy.
Geek and Sassy, yes, talking Justice League Dark, and that was a lot of fun.
That was episode 29, so episode 30 of Geek and Sassy should be out this week, I think. And also the Freak Out Drive-In sometime soon. So lots of Jenny on the feed again. I'm at JennyCruz2814 on Twitter. And what you got, Tim?
I don't really got shit this month. I will be on the giant-sized edition of Hard Traveling Fanboys, as Greg mentioned, coming out the final week of November. All three of us will be on that program. You will learn the winner of the by third and place to be late Peter Dick comic draft.
Fabian Nicieza, Scott Lobdell.
Thank you.
AJ Lieberman. Comics draft.
Yes, Chuck Austin. The winner will be unveiled on that show, so be looking forward to that one. I will have an episode of Survey Says. I don't know if it'll make it out before the end of this month, in all honesty, full disclosure. But it's on the way. It's in the bag. In the can.
Yay!
Yeah. On social, I am at Cyke68, C-Y-K-E-6-8, for Twitter, and you can find me on guysinsweatpants.com as
well. Yes! Oh my god, please let somebody pull that up and tell us about it.
If you have any complaints about opening that link, you can tweet them to us all at JRBBQ on Twitter.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Be sure to open that while you're at work.
Definitely.
Or in front of a bunch of preschoolers.
Yeah, for sure. Or like old ladies.
Yes, or in church.
That could have happened to me today, by the way. I was actually working around preschoolers today, so...
No, don't do that for real.
No, not a good idea.
No. But thank you, Greg. It was enlightening.
Yes.
And entertaining.
Hopefully.
It was everything I would dreamed it would be. Now I'm going to go read some E-Fed. So, see y'all.
Very good. What a world. Thanks, guys.
Unleashed. Thank you, sir.
Bye. I said, what about you? Breakfast and dinner.